Okay, thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here. So I'm a little jet lagged, so if I say stupid things, you forgive me. So I'm going to talk about a series of works I've been doing with a bunch of people, mostly with two of my students, Armand Joulin and Piotr Bojanowski, and a few postdocs, Korean postdocs, actually, Min Soo Cho, Bumsum Ham, and Sua Kwak. So I'm a computer vision person. Computer vision nowadays, the fashion is to do a lot of benchmarking and show you a lot of tables. I will not do much of that, just a teeny bit. I will also not discuss visual features in detail. And I will not pretend that that the way we implement things, that our algorithms or methods are the best, but I think some of the underlying ideas are interesting. Okay, and so I'm going to talk about supervision and the lack thereof. In the previous talk, you know, we talked about CNNs and things like that. I'm not going to talk about CNNs at all, except maybe the last couple of slides. But I'm going to talk about the problem of supervision. So typical problem in computer vision, you want to recognize objects. It is, you are given a bunch of training examples, images of beavers, chairs, trees, etc. And so somebody put those pictures in bags and put the label beaver, label chair, label tree. And then you train some machine, and then at the end, you give you a new image, the one on the right, and the machine is supposed to say beaver. And as you probably all know, this is usually formalized as a supervised machine learning problem. You are in some feature space, and then you train your machine by computing some prediction function f that's going to minimize the average of the discrepancy between labels that are given to you at training time and the prediction and the data, and then you regularize it so that you control the type of functions that you observe. And here the illustration that I have is for linear methods, where you work in Hilbert spaces, functional spaces over the data. But of course, there are also non-linear methods, such as neural networks. But for all these methods, what they assume is that you are given the labels here, the ZNs. Okay? And of course, this is expensive. So there's a trend. So I don't know what your background is, but there's a trend in the computer vision community to label everything. Okay, so year after year, people label more and more stuff. So this is an example from MS Coco, and this is an example I took a year ago, so probably MS Coco is even bigger than that. So they asked some guys to label images such as this one and to delineate all the objects of interest in this image. So if you give me a mouse and a picture like that, and you ask me to delineate the object of interest, that will take me about 20 minutes to do that. I've never done it, I have no idea, but it will take me a long, long time. And they did that for 400,000 pictures, okay? Which is good, because it gives you benchmarks, it gives you difficult problems, it gives you rigorous way of evaluating things. But it is bad as well. It is bad because it's too expensive and it's a bit crazy to do that. But also there are biases, because very often these benchmarks are not related to real tasks. I mean, the previous talk, those were real tasks, but very often computer vision, those are fake tasks. A bunch of guys that go in the dark room and they decide which pictures they are going to put in their bags. And there's another problem that I think is quite interesting, and that people don't have a good understanding for in vision, is that this level of granularity. Where do you stop? So those guys label what they imagine are a sheep and a dog and some guy, but why didn't they label the grass? Why didn't they label the individual grass blades? Okay. So this idea of labeling the whole world, I think, is not. To me, it's not the way to go, especially if, I'm going to talk about video as well, and in video you have to do that for, you know, zillions of millions of pictures over time and whatever. So what this talk is about is how to try to deal with this by using less information, less manual annotation. And I'm going to give you a bunch of examples, some technical stuff. It's very simple, some technical stuff about them. And we'll move from not much information to no information at all in the end. So to start, let's look at the cosegmentation problem. So in the cosegmentation problem, nobody delineates for you the objects in the training data. The only thing that you hear, the task is to segment the image, that is to separate it into regions, more or less a foreground region and background region, or maybe sometimes multiple regions that may correspond to interesting objects. But to train in cosegmentation, nobody delineates anything for you. The only supervision that you have, it's a weak form of supervision, is that you are told these pictures belong to the same bag. They contain something in common. They don't tell you what. And you want to use that information to segment the images. And so these are some of the outputs of the algorithm that Armand Joulin did with Francis Beck and me a couple of years ago. And as you can see, it gives reasonable results. In most of the examples I'm going to show you examples where the method works. Of course, there are plenty of examples where it gives it gives bad results. But here it works reasonably well. If you look at the Stonehenge pictures, for example, I find it's remarkable that it works so well. And I find also strange that picture with the elephants, but maybe I shouldn't spend time on that. All right, so does it work? The idea is very simple. It's just to generalize supervised classification. So this is the supervised classification scheme I was showing you before, where you know the labels. And there's something called discriminative clustering that was introduced in the mid-2000s, and that exploited this idea. And the idea is very simple. There are two ingredients. One is that to do this clustering into categories that you don't know, what you are going to do is not only optimize over the classifier, but you are going to optimize over the labels. Okay, so this time you don't know the Z's, you are going to try to compute them. And since this is in general complicated, what you are going to do is instead of taking a complex loss function, you are going to take the square loss function. Why? Because when you try to optimize over the classifier, you get the classifier in closed form. It's rich regression problem. Okay, so you knock off the classifier, and all you are left is an optimization over the label Z, which is a quadratic optimization problem. And this through relaxation you can do efficiently. Okay, so for cosegmentation, what we did is we just took that idea and generalized it a teeny bit. We changed the classifier from a square loss to a softmax because we wanted to do multi-class things and it seemed a good idea. We added the spectral clustering things to group together pieces of images that belong together. And then this made these discriminative clustering methods have a problem. They tend to put all the pixels into the same class. So we add an entropy term at the end that kind of spreads out the wealth and prevents that. But otherwise, you can see the same type, really the same type of technique. Of course, then you need to see how you can optimize it, so you relax it. The problem is non-convex, so because of the entropy terms. And so we are going to do block coordinate descent. You need to initialize that thing with reasonable approximation. So you do a Taylor expansion near zero, and you get a quadratic form that you can do in closed form. And then you have to do rounding. Okay, and with that, you get the results I showed to you. This is an example of the same method applied to three pictures in the same shot of the same movie. And as you can see, and of course, it's kind of the ideal setting because the illumination conditions will be roughly the same. There will be the same characters in the movie, and we'll have the same appearance. The background will change a bit. And as you can see, this thing succeeds in finding pretty well the main characters. It doesn't segment them exactly. There's a shoulder patch here that's missing, but who cares? All we care about if we want to extract information from an image is that we get the rough shape of the object. So that brings us to video. So in the previous case, so I was relying on some amount of manual annotation. That is, there are people who come and say, well, these pictures, I put them in a bag because they contain something in common. Here, I don't want to have manual information. What I want to do is exploit metadata that may come with various types of images or videos. In the case of videos, it's a remark that was done by Lapteff and Perez, is that you should be able to exploit the script data that comes in movies. So if you take any movie or any TV series, of course it's shot after a script, and that script, that text, contains information that's correlated with the visual information. So this is an example from Casablanca, and space of the script. So as the head waiter takes them to a table, and you can see it's correlated to the waiter, I think Dalio that's taking Ingrid Bergman, I don't remember the name of the actor, to their table. Then she passes Sam, she looks at him, and you can see that it's also correlated to visual content. And same thing here, where Sam keeps his eye on the keyboard and all. And so the idea is that there is a correlation between the text and the visual content, so can we use that text to inform us about the content of the video and figure out what's interesting in the video. So scripts are available for many, many movies and many, many series. First, they always exist, but the production companies don't always give them to you, but many of them are on the web. Plus, there are some people who apparently enjoy typing scripts as they watch movies and TV series, and they put them on the web. But the script is like a piece of paper. It's not synchronized with the video. Okay. On the other hand, any film or any series, a TV series, comes with subtitles for people who are hard of hearing. And the subtitles contain, of course, the dialogues. Okay. But the script also contains the dialogues. The subtitles are time-stamped, and so you can align the script with the subtitles relatively easily using dynamic programming, and then you timestamp your piece of script. And so that piece of script has the waiter, blah, blah, blah. You know that the dialogue is at such time, the dialogue is at such time, and so that you know that what is described here will happen in that first second, 30-second slice of time. And then you can try to use that to figure out what is happening in that particular time. Here's an example. You would like to identify characters in a movie and also what they do. And so here the script tells you Rick's woke up behind Ilsa. You can imagine that you do some face detection and you get those yellow blocks, and then you want to label them with the name of the person, and then you also want to say what is each person doing. Okay. So it's easy to formulate that using the same discriminative clustering formulation that we have. Again, this time we are going to have two label variables, one for character names, one for action names. And so we have these two variables. There will be linear constraints that tell you that if the person is mentioned in that piece of the script, if that action is mentioned in that piece of the script, then that action and that person should appear at least once. So you have this linear constraint about that. But then you have linking constraints between the person and the actions, that both of them should appear at the same time. And so those are nonlinear, again, non-convexities, etc. You need to be able to optimize that. So again, we relax, we block coordinate descent, we initialize one of them by taking a uniform distribution over time, and then we round them. Okay, it's no big deal in doing all that. So you see the kind of things that you get. It takes a while to start. Again, green is good, red is bad. The face is found by some off-the-shelf face detector. The body is the larger rectangle. It's just an offset and scale version of the face, and it's not perfect, but it's a relatively difficult task. And sometimes, of course, it doesn't pick up the people. Okay. All right. So So often people who deal with video treat video as a kind of three-dimensional block of data. It's not quite right because video has a, you know, time doesn't go backwards in most cases, and so we need to use that temporal information. So that leads us to the next thing. Here the idea is you are going to get this piece of script. We are going to do some, I don't know, keyword mining, whatever. We decide on the vocabulary of action, so I don't know, sit down, open door, whatever is written there. And then for a given piece of script, we mine which ones of these keywords or synonyms of these keywords are going to happen. And then we are going to make the assumption that the temporal order in the video and in the scripts are going to be the same. That is that if in the script say open door before sit down, then it should be the same in the video. Okay? How can you formulate that? Well, we are again going to write it as a, it's again very close to discriminative clustering. What we are going to do, so here, how do we represent things? We have our dictionary of actions. There's an empty action because there will be plenty of frames where nothing in the dictionary is happening. Then we have the metadata is given by that mapping A. That tells you that the kth action in the script corresponds to whatever entry in the dictionary. And then you will have a mapping between time frames. This is a small m here, between time frames and your action and your metadata. So what you want to do is, again, optimize your classifier. But this time, instead of having just the label, you are going to have the entry in the table that corresponds to your assignment. And the temporal order is maintained corresponds to the fact that the path that you have is monotonous. Okay? So it turns out that one possibility to the representation of the problem is to mix together your metadata and your unknown assignment into an indicator variable. And then you will have complicated constraints on these indicator variables that are associated with the fact that you have a monotonous path. Okay? If you do that, you get back to the usual setting, and you recognize the square loss, etc., etc. But the difficulty now is that when you try to do optimization, you are going to try to do optimization of a discrete domain that's defined by very complicated and implicit constraints. So doing that optimization is not obvious. Okay? So when we relax it, instead of relaxing it on the discrete domain, we are going to relax it on its convex hull. And fortunately, there's a nice way to do optimization over that convex hull using the so-called Frankhoff algorithm, which is an old algorithm that has become popular in the last few years in the machine learning community. And what's the idea is that you have a convex function defined over a convex domain, but that domain may be very complicated and you may not have an explicit description for that domain. And the nice quality of Frankhoff is that you can find the global optimum of your problem if you have an oracle function that allows you to do optimization on a tangent plane to that surface. Okay, and it's an iterative algorithm. Basically, you optimize over the tangent plane, and then you take a point, not midway, but somewhere on the way between the optimum you have found and your current point. There's a way to find the scale factor, and this thing will iterate. In our case, this optimization over the tangent plane can be done using dynamic programming, so it can be done efficiently. Okay. And this is the kind of things you can do. We took a bunch of movies, we decided on a vocabulary, and then we let it fast forwards. And when the program thinks that he has found some action, it slows down and it displays it. And of course, again, sometimes it fails completely, but I show you examples where it works quite well. And those are not easy. What we did is that we wanted to evaluate this thing quantitatively, they wanted to evaluate these things. So we asked somebody to actually annotate by hand where they thought that the actions were happening in the movie. And so the wider bands at the bottom, that's where the person annotated. The narrow bands, that's where the program found. And I think this is the next example that I like. So the yellow thing is drinking. The white yellow thing is the person annotating it. The thin yellow thing is the program finding the action drinking. And I think both make sense. So for the person, this is drinking. So drinking, are you want to drink? I pour you a drink, blah, blah, blah. It's a social thing. For the computer, pssst. And both are very reasonable. And I think that's interesting because in most of computer vision research and visual recognition, the semantics of the labels is absent. So you have labels, you call it drink or seat or potato or banana, but they should be 1, 2, 3, 4, or A, B, C, D. They are pure symbols. You never is exaggerating. But by and large, you don't use the semantics of the labels. Okay? So it's quite reasonable that somebody would call drink something like this, and somebody would call drink something like this. Okay. I'm going fast, that's good. And so this idea brought us to try and consider the problem totally unsupervised interpretation of images and video. This time, no labels. Here, you know, it seems easy, but it's really not that easy. There was no manual annotation for that movie. But still, we are using the script. Here, what I'm going to do is, instead of people putting things in different bags, I'm putting everything in the same bag, figure out for yourself what's in there. Okay? And that's actually the idea of Min Su Cho, a former postdoc of mine. And there are several key ideas. The first one is that this idea that nobody really uses the semantics. Labels are just a way to put things to bags. They are just a way to put things together that people think belong together. Okay. So the supervision, by and large, is used to say these three things belong together. So some people may say those are horse pictures, some people may say those are horse riding pictures, some people may say those are banana pictures, I don't care. The main thing is that people think these things belong together. Okay? If that is the case, maybe you can replace that supervision process by an automated process that just say, well, these pictures, they look like each other, so they belong together. Okay, so that's idea number one. Idea number two is that if you think that way, if you take a collection of pictures, say the internet, and of course we don't do it at internet scale, but say the internet, this collection of pictures has some underlying implicit structure, some kind of graph structure. Two pictures are linked implicitly because they contain things that look like each other. Okay? And it would be nice to discover that structure. And if you know that structure, third idea, then you can use that as supervisory signal. Okay? So that's the whole idea, and I personally think that's a very good idea. Now what I'm going to show you is how we do it, and I'm not going to say that this is the good way to do it. It's a way to do it. The same way as before we do all this discriminative clustering, which is very simple, that may not be the best way to do it, but it's a good idea to use metadata, etc. There's another idea that I think is good, is that is this idea of parts. But I will come back to that later. So the way we are going to do it is we are going to represent pieces of images by regions. So we pick, say, random regions in an image. And some of these random regions may enclose interesting parts of the images, interesting objects in the images. So in this case, for example, the red one could enclose the bike. And some other of these regions may correspond to, say, salient parts defined in some sense of these objects we are finding. And then, of course, some other regions may correspond to random stuff. Okay, so we are going to try to match images by finding regions that, that may correspond to objects or their parts. Okay, so in reality, in the vision community, object proposals have become popular. So you have some bottom-up process that puts a rectangle where it thinks that it might be something interesting. Personally, I'm not so keen on that because I don't see why this should work without any prior information. But to be pragmatic, it works better by using those region proposals than by using random regions. Okay. And so what we are going to do is we are going to try to bring in some, when we match these regions, we are going to try to bring in some geometric, very simple geometric information to match region. So imagine we take two images. We have all these region proposals in the first image, 2,000 roughly. We take between 2,000 and 5,000 region proposals in each image. We take all these region proposals in the first image, all region proposals in the second image, and then we look at a possible match. So a possible match M is a pair of regions, one in the left image, one in the right image. Okay. And what we would like to estimate is the probability that this match is correct, given all the data that we observe. So small d here is all the data that we observe. Okay, so that's a reasonable thing to do. And what we are going to do is try to marginalize, try to use Bayes' rule and marginalizing over possible configurations of the two images, that is possible offsets between the region in left image, region in right image. And by offset, I mean translation and scale. Okay, if you want, you could do rotation, whatever. But so the configuration C here is translation and scale. Okay, so we marginalize over it. And so we are going to, the probability will be decomposed over probability of the match given the configuration times the prior probability of the configuration given all the data. Now, then what we do is say, appearance and geometry are decoupled. They're independent from each other. So we can factor the first term into two, one that depends on any appearance, the other one that depends on your geometry. So the appearance term can be any similarity measure between patches after normalization, of course, that you want. Euclidean distance, if you want, or correlation between shift or whatever. The geometry term can be just, for example, something based on the size of the region after you have applied the offset. Those are simple. I mean, you can come up with any one you want. The complicated term is probably the configuration given the data, and that we don't know. Okay, so we don't know it. So when we don't know something, we make up an approximation for it. So we use what's called probability of transform. That's not a very nice term, but we use a proxy for that probability of a configuration given all the data. What we're going to do is we are going to take all possible matches and we are going to make them vote for that particular configuration. Okay? So we are going to see if, given among all the match, if a match is compatible with the configuration, it will give a good vote for that configuration, and a better vote even if the appearance is good. Okay? This is an approximation, but it's relatively reasonable. And it can be computed. Okay, so that's for a match. Now, that's it, only two images. If you want to have it's not only two images, it's for a match. Now, if you want to get confidence for a given region, you want to get the maximum of that score over all possible matches that include that region. Okay? So an example to see how it works. There are two images, all the candidate regions in the two images. And then if you color code each region in each image by its confidence, you can see that and blue is not confident, red is very confident. You can see that the red regions are going to concentrate on the salient objects in the picture. So we don't know it's a horse, but there are two horses, they look like each other, and the two backgrounds don't look like each other. That's why it concentrates on horses. It could concentrate on trees instead of horses if there's no structure there. And at the top, what we have done is just display the top 20 scores, top 20 matches rather in the two images. And as you see, they rather concentrate on the score. So that's encouraging. If you don't use the geometry term, it's much more diffuse and you don't get any structure. Okay. What is this one? I'm not sure why. I'm sorry, I'm jet lag. I guess it's just because that was a different example, and the PHM again concentrates on the thing. So this was just for two images. If you do multiple images, well, you are going to take the average for each region of, or the sum of the score for that region. And it turns out the more images you have, the better, the more concentrated things become. So at the bottom, you have between two images, and if you have multiple images, you see that you have a lot more of these red regions. Okay? Again, this assumes that the images that we are trying to match are linked, that is, that we assume that they contain some common thing that's interesting. One thing that we would like to capture is this idea of part. Is that, you know, you have an object, it will be a box that more or less tightly contains it, and then there will be bits within that correspond to object parts. And we don't know how to do that. I think I will come back to that a bit later, I think, but the one of the things people in vision don't know how to do today is reason about parts in an intelligent manner. And it's a shame because I think that's important. I will show you a couple of examples later. So here, at least, what we would like to do is say that you would like, if a region is too big, imagine you just want the tight box. If the region is too big, then it will contain more background than the tight box. If it is too small, then it will contain less foreground than the tight box. So we should be able to use that. The second one, we don't know how to do it. So far, we have some ideas, but we don't know how to do it. So for the time being, we just use the first one, and we define a silency score as the difference between the score of a region and the max of all the regions that contain it. And that tends to select regions that tightly bound objects. This is a heuristic, but why not? But this actually, I think, this is an important point. Trying to understand these ideas of what's inside, what's outside is important. And now the algorithm, this is it, it's very simple. You take a bunch of images, and then you initialize it by looking for the nearest neighbors of one image according to some criterion. Okay, so at the beginning, you don't have any region matching information, you don't have anything, so you have to take some global descriptor. We use a descriptor introduced by Efros and and his wife, no, not his wife, by not Efros, by Toralba and his former wife, Oliva, here we go, girlfriend, sorry, don't film that. It's the jet lag, it doesn't tell. Anyway, there's some global descriptor called GIST that's reasonable. That's reasonable for finding two images that more or less look like each other. So we look for the nearest neighbors. Of course, it's a toy example. We can make mistakes in that process, of course. And then we try to match those. Okay? Once we have done those match, we have some hypotheses for the same object in our target image. And then we can use that to refine the search. Well, we do it all over, and then we can do that to refine the search for nearest neighbors. And it's very simple. I'm not saying this is the way this should be done, but it's just a way of implementing what I think is a good idea. So does it work? Does it work in general? In general, it works pretty well. You get better matches after a few iterations. This is after one iteration. So you get some random stuff, and you get this big three regions up there. After a few iterations, concentrates on the object. Of course, it's anecdotal evidence and just an example. But also, the retrieval, the search for neighbors improves with iterations. At the first iterations, you get all sorts of random things. Here, after five iterations, you get essentially cars, which is what you want. Okay. And so you iterate for a few iterations and you're done. So because I didn't put it in a slide, I'm going to forget if I don't see it now. So of course this is ugly. We are not even optimizing a function. Okay, we have an algorithm and it does stuff. It doesn't lower error of whatever. It does stuff. This is ugly. And of course we are not trying to formalize it as a proper optimization problem and then finding a proper way of solving the proper optimization problem, of course. So what's interesting is to try it. So I said I would not show too many benchmarks, but the idea is that we took there's a classical benchmark in vision called Pascal VOC07. So we took all the images, put it in one bag, check it, and give it to the program. And then we report core lock, which is the correct localization, if my memory is correct. Well, oh yeah, this is unsupervised, so it's always difficult to evaluate unsupervised methods because they're unsupervised. So what we do to evaluate it, we took Pascal 07, that where people have put bounding boxes around objects of interest, because it's a database designed for object detection. And so when we say we're happy, when the candidate object that we find coincides, that is overlaps enough, one of the things that have been marked. And core lock is aware that it overlaps, it's kind of intersection of a union or something like that. Okay. And so what's interesting, if you like, at the top table, so this is per class, so we don't have this thing of mixing the classes together, but there is no supervision whatsoever except for the fact that we say it's not in the same class, and all the other methods have some supervision with negative example, even with some pre-trained CNN methods. And with very, very little supervision, we do quite well. And then we can also check everything, and that's the second table, and it still does very well. And none of these other methods works for that. And so I think that's interesting. Now, if you look at, those are some examples of successes. Those are some examples of failures. And these are anecdotal as well. Yeah, I'm not saying that the failures are always like that. But a failure that's observed sometimes, often, and which I think is natural. We find the head of the cow, or the head of the dog, or the wheel of the bike. What's wrong with that? It's unsupervised. And if you mix pictures, and you have faces, you know, faces are salient things, and the face of a dog looks like the face of a man, looks like the face of a goat. I mean, pretty much, not exactly, but you have two eyes, nose, mouth, ears. And so it's a salient thing to find. And again, this has to do with this part thing, and I think this failure mode of many detection algorithms, what is magic about the body, about a box over the body? And so, but we don't have a good way of reasoning about parts in general, I think. I think nobody knows how to do that, but I think it's a really important problem. So since we could do it in still images, we tried to do it in videos as well. And that's the work mostly of Sua Kwak, with Min Su Cho, and I forget, I should mention Francis Beck or Lia Schmidt, and are also involved in most of this work. And the idea, we are going to do the same thing as before, but we are going to introduce some temporal consistency. So I'm not going to bore you with the details, but we can do that. And then you can do these things. We took clips from the Jason Bourne movies, and we took clips that contains a lot of car chases. And we let the computer figure out what it was interesting. And of course, there are lots of car chases, so it likes cars. But you know, it's moving. The camera is moving. The cars are translating, but they are turning. Sometimes they don't move, and it works relatively well. And my favorite example is this one. We gave the program the movie Babe, so it's the adventures of a talking pig. I've never seen it, but it's supposed to be pretty good. And the program got pretty good at finding Babe. And in general, animals and their faces. But very good at Babe. There you go. But we didn't write to the New York Times to tell them we did that, but it's totally unsupervised. You give it the movie. So I'm pretty happy about those results. And you find sheep's face, and then I think there are monkeys later, and if I had, pigs' butts, and maybe some dogs. But it's not so bad. Okay, and more Babe. See, it finds monkeys as well. But that doesn't bother me at all. What's wrong with finding the monkey's face as Babe's face? There are faces. And of course, I don't think you'd want to, if you want to deploy an object recognition system, you don't want it to be fully unsupervised. There will always be some metadata. But I think it's interesting and important to look at this unsupervised thing and what you can do without any prior knowledge. So these methods can be extended. I'm not to go into the technical details, but the way we treat geometry here is too is very important to have geometry. It makes a huge difference, but it's too global because we get everything to vote. So we also introduce a local voting procedure that I'm not going to describe, and that improves things quite a bit. And we also use that to match images, to obtain what's called sometimes thin flow. That is, you have optical flow, you have two images of the same scene, but the camera has moved a bit, and you want to see how the pixels have moved in the image, the optical flow. Thin flow is when you have two images of the same category, same type of objects, but they are not the same object. And you would like to find the deformation from one image to the other. And you can use these methods basically because you can do this region matching and then you can interpolate the deformation between the regions. And this is an example of what you get. So on the left, you have two pairs of images. And what we are trying to do is deform the first image in the pair into the second one. And we overlay, so here are the deformed versions and here are the deformed versions overlaid on the image and we compare our method to a bunch of classical methods for that problem. And as you see, it does pretty well. And interestingly enough, I think it's essentially the only method that gives you a different image that looks like a real image. Maybe it's even more, I think you can probably see that on the Dalmatian and even on the hand. And like for example, for Snoopy, it actually overlaps the thing very well. There's just the arms that can't be overlapped well because they are not in the same configuration. Okay. And you can even match drawing of a pizza to the pizza itself pretty well. So I think that was interesting. So what we are do, and I'm almost done. It's funny because it was totally unsupervised, but now we want to go back to very supervised. So we'd like to use the same kind of ideas, but this time you know a priori that two images are in the same category, you want to match them. And we'd like to learn the matching process. So it's not too complicated. This was our semi-probabilistic approach. Now we are going to replace all the probabilities or proxies for probabilities by similarity functions. We can rewrite all these terms, it's the same as this. And then the W here will be the parameters that you are going to try to learn. So I'm going to try to learn similarity functions while having some geometric constraints over them. It turns out we could have done it there as well. It turns out when you do it, you have some kernel that appears in the middle. But you have, basically, you get similar function based on the individual match similar function, some geometric kernel and some neighboring matches. And then that's the glee. What I don't like about CNN papers is all these drawings. I think they are horrible. You know, where people put all these layers, they have five conf nets, three max pooling, two fully connected, whatever, 64, I don't know. So for me, that's a black box. And this picture is a bit too complicated for me because I don't understand it, but apparently the dotted thing helps. But the solid thing I understand. Basically, that's what you... All this is so you have a black box that computes F, okay, and it's a black box that's differentiable, so it's called net. And then what this does is compute the function I was showing you in the previous slide. And then you optimize, and then you get something that can match regions. So we have to. There are not that many methods that do that. It's an old idea to learn too much. That comes back to 10 years ago, a paper by Jan Lucan. We are trying to learn stereo matching. There's a paper by people from Stanford, recent paper, people from Stanford and NEC, that's trying to do essentially the same idea. But it doesn't have the geometric knowledge. So as expected, we do quite a bit better. What's interesting, this is interesting. I think this is interesting. This is, we have. I told you that we have this localized way of using geometry, and we have not implemented it in this approach yet. But we have seen that if you use the features that we have learned in our previous approach instead of using SIFT or whatever, then we get a lot better results with the localized thing. So that means that when we implement the localized thing in this network, we should do a lot better. So I think that's kind of interesting. And I think I will stop there. So it was just a short tour in our experience with weekly supervised and unsupervised thing, which I think is a key component of what we should do in vision today. Thank you.
Any questions? Comments?
Yes.
There are very few deep learning examples. How do you explain that?
I like deep learning, but I am not obsessed by it. And it doesn't work for unsupervised and weakly supervised, so which is good. Okay. And so that's pretty much it. But I like deep learning. I think it's good.
And the more philosophical question: do you think that there are still problems left to solve in vision, or it's a problem that it's a community number that is moving to industry, and we will be out of jobs soon, and we have to convert ourselves to artificial intelligence?
Yeah, so we have to convert ourselves to artificial intelligence for several reasons, but I think it's very good that some of it has moved to industry. If industry believed that this was a done deal, they wouldn't, they wouldn't sponsor us, they wouldn't hire our students, they wouldn't try to work with us, they wouldn't have research labs, etc. So I think most of the innovation still comes from academia. And I think, so again, unsupervised, and I don't know. I'm not the usual follower of CNNs in the world. I mean, there are people who are much more knowledgeable than me. But I don't know any work, unsupervised, that work in that area. What I have all told people a lot is, if you look at the old CNN papers, they were not just doing CNNs. If you look at the paper that introduced the net, they have something called graph transformational networks that are structured, that are a lot more complicated, where you have differential blocks that talk to each other, and that's how they manage to read the checks, not by using the net, but using that stuff. So I think the idea of having differentiable learning systems that you can learn end-to-end is good, of course. I think you need to look at, I think, more interesting block structure, where you understand a bit how you program that thing. And I think just doing, you know, this is not so interesting. But so I'm not pessimistic at all. I think we are in good shape. I think it's good we're having an industrial impact, and at the same time that there are plenty of interesting problems left, I think. Maybe I'm naive.
More questions? Okay, so maybe we can find the speaker again.
Thank you.